There are three types of problems in life, according to complexity scientist Scott E. Page, and they are the Mount Fujis, the Rockies, and the dancing landscapes. If paralysis by analysis is what's holding you back, like it is for me, then knowing these types of three problems and which one you're facing helps you not only know one, whether you can optimize or not, and two, how to actually optimize. So let's get into these three frameworks. First, come to Japan and look at Mount Fuji. This is our first type of problem, and as you see, it's got this iconic cone shape, iconic pyramid shape with one summit, one peak on this mountain. So when problems are like Mount Fuji, one, it is definitely possible to optimize because there's one peak. And two, it is relatively straightforward. You just have to go up. So what does this mean in life? Well, let's take careers, choices for what you want to do as an example. If you choose careers such as doctors, lawyers, accountants, anything in professional services, usually to get to the top is like climbing Mount Fuji. You have to go to school, you have to get a degree, you have to pass an exam, and you just continue working until you are at the summit. Relatively straightforward. Not easy, but the path is clear. Of course, not everyone is on this path. So let's take a look at the second type of problem, which is the Rockies. Let's go to the Pacific Northwest. I'm from Vancouver, so this is close to my heart. But if you're from other places, the Himalayas, the Alps, any places where there is a mountain range and there are multiple peaks and valleys, then this is problem number two. In this type of problem, there are multiple paths, and they all seem to be leading upwards. So which path do you choose? It's really hard to see which peak is the highest as well. So even if you start to move up, you see that, okay, I'm on one of the peaks, but there are actually other peaks that are higher than this one. So what do you do then? This creates three problems that we didn't have in Mount Fuji. Number one, it's unclear where the global peak is. So we can talk about this in mathematical terms, where there are local peaks, which is the highest point in comparison to its neighbors, but that doesn't mean it's the highest point in the entire Rockies, in the entire mountain range. There's also a global peak, which is the highest peak of them all, but it is hard to discern where that is. Sometimes it's even hard to see. Even with the Rockies, it took a really long time for people to determine that Mount Elbert was actually the highest point in the Rockies. And if we think of peaks as what we're optimizing for, as we did with the Mount Fuji example, then not knowing where the peak is going to be a problem, right? This is a what problem of what are we optimizing for? The second problem this poses is that even if we knew where we wanted to go, there are so many paths that seem to be leading towards the same general direction. So which path do we take, right? This is the how question. How do we optimize? Let's say once we are on a local peak and we look out and there are multiple mountains peaks out there. It's not so easy to just leap from one peak to another. We still have to do the work. We still have to go up and down. And so how do we know where we want to go first and then where we want to go next? So here is a where question. Where do we want to optimize? And this is the difference between a Mount Fuji problem and a Rockies problem. There is interaction between our choices. And we choose one action and it will have subsequent impacts on our following actions. So what does this mean for life? Let me give you an example from Professor Page. Let's say you're renovating your house and you want to make the entrance bigger. So you remove one of the closets in the bedroom in order to make space. It's good that the entrance is now bigger, but you lost the closet in your bedroom. So all your clothes are now on the floor. Well, that doesn't make the house very comfortable. So now you create a new closet and put it somewhere else. Well, let's say that blocks a window. Now, even though you have a closet, the room is not comfortable because you have less light. So then you have to find a way to get more light back into your room. So this is how our choices impact each other. And like we said before, there's so many paths we can take in the Rockies problem. So how do we actually know we're heading up and towards the right peak? So the Rockies sound quite complicated, right? But actually, it's not as bad as the dancing landscape, which we'll talk about in just a moment, because things are still static. Let me give you another example related to the career one I gave at the beginning. Say for me, I started with law. So I was climbing that Mount Fuji. It was very clear. How do you get to the top? But I decided it wasn't for me, so I moved into consulting. And then I moved into entrepreneurship. I was trying to explore what are the things I can do. By doing that, I came down the Mount Fuji path and I went into the Rockies. In the Rockies, I explored different things I want to optimize for. I wanted to optimize for time, for money, for family, for health, all of these things. And while I saw some promising peaks, I was still exploring. I didn't know which peak do I want to end up. So that led me to Google to work with others on bigger problems that I couldn't do by myself. So the Rockies problem, lots of different possibilities, lots of things that you can be optimizing for, and you have to make choices that affect your subsequent choices. Now, let's go to the third type of problem, which is the dancing landscape. In the dancing landscape, all of a sudden, there's a lot more complexity. It's like the rugged landscape of the Rockies, except now things are dancing. And what I mean by that is that peaks can become valleys. Valleys can then go become peaks. They could be local peaks at one point, global peaks at another time, and things are always changing. And you might ask, okay, what makes a problem dance like this? It's the interaction between our actions and the actions of others. So remember, in the Rockies, it was just the interaction between our own choices, our own actions. They affected each other. But now we add a new layer of what other people are doing and how that's affecting us. Life is usually like this, right? We don't live in a vacuum. What other people do affect us, what we do affect them. And so let's come back to the career change example. I was in the Rockies when I didn't care about what other people were thinking, but friends and family would make casual remarks, like, why are you enjoying your life now when you could be hustling? Or the media would be promoting, you know, having more, whatever it is, right? It starts to affect how we make those decisions and we become more interdependent on others. Then, all of a sudden, my landscape started to dance. What I thought was a peak of exploring what life has to offer, trying to find out what I wanted in life, then became a valley. It didn't seem so important. It was important to optimize, say, things like prestige. And so that factored into my decision to go into Google, and instead of being in the Rockies landscape, instead of being in the Mount Fuji landscape, I brought myself into a dancing landscape. Is it good or bad? I don't know, because I don't have control over what other people do or what they think. And that affects how I do, so I don't know what will happen. For example, Google, definitely a very prestigious name, very smart people, you know, all of these good things that's happening for it. But then, let's say, you know, they introduce Bard as a response to ChatGPT, and things don't go so well. Well, now they're saying, okay, maybe it's the end of an era. How embarrassing, right? And then, you know, who knows? A few months later, something else happens that's innovative, that's exciting, and now the prestige goes back up. So in a dancing landscape, you have to always be moving to stay on the peaks. This is the same with any big corporations, right? The goals are always changing. So even though you're doing your best towards something, when they say, okay, priorities have now changed, it's really difficult to stay on the peak because now what you were doing, which was going up towards a peak, now doesn't matter so much. And you have to recalibrate and go towards the new peak. But then when that changes, what do you do, right? So it's a very difficult situation where you have less control because you're interdependent on other people's choices and actions. That's what I meant when I said the Rockies are actually not that complex. Because everything is static, you can work out the solution to the problem. Whereas in the dancing landscape, it is always changing. Because you don't know, you have to see which one takes off. You can't calculate, you can't analyze and come up with the right answer. Analysis in the landscape will not give you the perfect answer. So what does this mean for our lives now that we know there are three types of problems? Well, number one is to know which mountain you're on, right? Are you on the Mount Fuji, which then you know you don't need to overcomplicate anything, right? Just work hard and work up. Then if you're in the Rockies, know that it will take time because it's not so easy, right? You have to figure out which one you're optimizing for, which path you're taking, and how you can navigate towards what you want. And if you're in the dancing landscape, know that things will always change, and that is normal, right? That is the fundamental understanding in order to know and to be able to deal with the dancing landscape. And number two, now that you know which problem you're working on, see if you want to reduce the complexity of it. If you're facing a dancing landscape problem, in order to reduce complexity, you'll have to reduce the interdependencies between the different actors in the problem. To make a Rockies problem less complex, you'll have to reduce the interdependencies between one actor's decisions and actions. This means changing the overall approach to the problem, changing the mindset and the frameworks that you bring into the game. Sometimes it requires zooming out, right? Because you see what type of problem it is. This means reframing, right? Because you've stepped out and you've seen the overall problems that you're facing, reframing the problem is key, right? Einstein, Curie, Newton, they all solved dancing problems by changing them into Mount Fuji problems, right? That's why so many businesses that seem so simple, too simple, actually make millions, billions of dollars, right? If your goal is to optimize, then simplifying the problem with reframe is key. This is at the heart of framework thinking, to be able to simplify complicated situations and ideas. If you're curious about framework thinking, check out this video here, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.